Hey there, Cinder. Well, good afternoon, everyone. I was doing a little press over there, and I turned around, and the whole room was full, so I'm very pleased to see that. But it is indeed my pleasure to welcome you today to the first Governor's Workforce Summit. I know that several of you have traveled across the state to join us today for this summit, and I want to thank you for making the trip here and for being part of this milestone event. I'd also like to recognize and thank each of our speakers who are seated here on the front row. Today's summit will be full of great information about programs and opportunities available to help educate and train current and future workers in the Mountain State. And I hope you find their presentations very helpful. Now, during my time as Senate President, Senators, and now as Governor, I've made it a priority to not only improve our state's business climate, but to strengthen and grow West Virginia's workforce to meet the long-term needs of business and industry operating here in our state. In 2013, we took the first major step toward achieving that goal by signing comprehensive education reform into law. The foundation of this landmark initiative was reestablishing the West Virginia Workforce Planning Council to better align classroom learning with workplace needs. And what initially began as a 7-member council has transformed over the years and now includes several cabinet secretaries and working groups from a variety of state agencies, ranging from our West Virginia Department of Commerce and Department of Education to the West Virginia Department of Veterans Assistance. On this, on our Workforce Council, we have most of the members here today, is Secretary of Education and the Arts. And I'll tell you a little bit about why I put each one of those on this council. Under Kay's watch, she has the Division of Vocational Rehabilitation. And as you may know, we created GASCA. We've had our war on substance abuse in West Virginia because I hear as I travel around the state that it's very hard to find employees that can pass a drug test. And it's one of those things that we recognize it and we're doing our best by getting services out into the community to help those people that's afflicted with this. But also in rehab, I said, well, you know, if you have a substance abuse problem, that is a disability in a way because you really can't work and can't do things. And I said, hey, how about checking and see if we can't use federal funds to help people get rehab and some additional training to go back into the workforce? Lo and behold, we can. So that's one avenue that we got there, and Kay has been a very good member. Obviously, our Secretary of Commerce, Keith Burdett, is here because his department every day is out talking with businesses, both in-state looking to expand and those outside the state looking to come in. But one of the questions I always ask when we have new interests coming in to the state, do we have a trained workforce? And we always tell them right up front, we have a very hard-working workforce, but also we will provide whatever kind of training that you need to make sure your business is successful in West Virginia. Obviously, Secretary of DHHR, Karen Bowling, is on there, and she has several areas. She has her behavioral health, which helps also with substance abuse and the problems there, excuse me, and providing those services to those in need around the state. But also, she's in charge of social services. And that's those state benefits that people receive every month. And I said, you know, what we need to do is rather than, you know, just letting people get the check every month, we need to have our counselors in each of our county offices talking to these individuals and say, you know, you could have a better life. You could, you know, to be able to better yourself and your family and set examples for your children and still maintain insurance under the expanded health care that we have. That used to be one of the reasons where, especially a lot of single mothers, would say, I can't afford to get a job because if I do, I'll lose my insurance for my children. Well, those things have changed today. And anyhow, one of Karen's roles is to, once again, help with the outreach, to get people interested in going back and being able to help themselves, advance themselves and their families. We have our chancellors here today. We have, first of all, Chancellor Jim Skidmore with our Community and Technical College system. And Jim is working now with public education to do things that they've really not done before. For example, in our vocational programs or our career and technical education, as the new name for it, if a young person was to take welding, basic welding, and then they wanted to go on to advance themselves at the community and technical college level, a lot of times they'd have to start all over again, which is a waste of time. But I know that public education and the community colleges are working together now to make sure that there's a seamless transition so people will not have to duplicate services that or classes they've already had. Also, we got Chancellor Paul Hill here from the, it's on the council from the Higher Education Policy Commission. One of the other problems we have between the two, the community colleges and the four-year colleges, is that you really, it was very hard, there was no agreement to transfer the basic classes that people can go to community colleges to get, the English, the maths, and those kind of things, the core curriculum, and transfer them over. But the two chancellors have worked together. That's a lot more seamless now, where you're not wasting time of taking classes that won't transfer if you plan to go on to get a four-year degree. Excuse me. Also, we have the director of West Virginia's of Workforce West Virginia, Russ Fry, who's right here. Russ has got lots of money. And really, you know, has the outreach and works with a lot of different groups and agencies out there. But basic programs for almost any kind of training that we need. And it's one that I know Keith uses a lot of that money to help train and retrain people for new jobs coming in. But the other thing, if you look in areas like Southern West Virginia, where we've lost hundreds, if not thousands, of coal mining jobs, you know, there's money available there. If we can get those folks interested in coming back in, whether it be some kind of a technical training or whether it be some form of higher education. Excuse me. We've got the money to train those people, not only them, but their family members. It doesn't have to be the person laid off. And if I'm not mistaken, it's any other job that has been affected by the layoff in the mining industry can qualify to get this kind of help. So there's a lot of money there. We have Carolyn Stewart, who heads up our Herb Henderson Office of Minority Affairs. We have lots of unemployment in some of our minority communities, and one of the words that she is going out and spreading is there's money available if you want to get involved, to get training and job. You know, the state of West Virginia will find a way to get you that kind of training you need. Excuse me, a little allergies here today, but. And also we have Secretary of Veterans Assistance Rick Thompson on the council. And we have a lot of veterans coming back that served us overseas, been in the National Guard and so forth. And I know General Hoyer will be talking about that some. But we also have a lot of training dollars for our veterans in West Virginia. And one of the things I'm very glad to say is both our community college system and our higher education, our four-year institutions, all have somebody assigned to deal with veterans when they come in to explain the programs, as well as our veterans assistance offices in every county. You know, what we want veterans to know when they walk in, here are services available to you. You have served our country, and we're going to do what we can to get you a good paying job and get the kind of training that you need here in West Virginia. We have Mark Julian, who went from the Commerce Department over to the community and college system, and he's working with sector, what's it called? Sector strategies. We'll talk about that a little bit more later. And of course, we got our superintendent of schools, Dr. Michael Monterano, who basically is really working well to try to establish in our education system, doing the thing, looking after things we're doing with early childhood, and the other part about having all children reading at grade level by third grade, looking at our high dropout rate in our middle, where children start thinking about it in middle schools, and trying to get to those kids to make sure they're thinking about a career, not about dropping out of school and then ended up on the corner someplace. So anyhow, this council has allowed us to better align our resources and eliminate the bureaucratic silos that kept them from integrating our workforce training efforts to provide the best and most effective services to all West Virginians. There are a wide variety of programs available, from early childhood to middle school to high school to post-secondary training and education. And anyone who has a desire for a job can do it. and we're here to help them, whether through a certificate or an apprenticeship program, a two-year or four-year program, or a specialized retraining program. West Virginians have the opportunities to succeed. For the past 2 years, the Workforce Planning Council has operated somewhat behind the scenes, but West Virginia has a great story to tell, and it's time that we start telling it. Today is an opportunity for us to share some of the headway we're making and shine a light on the positive results that we've seen so far. We're collaborating with employers, and some of those employers you'll hear from today who had unmet workforce needs that we've worked on to meet over the years. And I urge all business and industry leaders to encourage to engage in these productive conversations. Because I can assure you that if a business operating in West Virginia has unmet workforce needs, we will do everything we can to address them. At the National Governors Association this past January in Washington, D.C., Millie Marshall, many of you know her, she's the president of Toyota Motor Manufacturing in West Virginia, she shared the importance of a well-trained workforce and how West Virginia is providing just that. And I was very impressed with what she had to say, so were the other governors in attendance. But I'd like to take a few minutes to give you the opportunity to hear her powerful words that she had to say about West Virginia.
What can states do to get more interest and get more companies, because this forum is on economic development? You know, definitely you have to have the infrastructure, you have to have roads, you have to have utilities, you have to have a good relationship with the business community, all those things, but every single one of you knows that. But the difference, I truly, truly believe, and a lot of people believe it's incentives, but you all know at the states, you know what Alabama's bidding for, and you know what Tennessee and West Virginia's bidding for, so that's no longer the big difference between getting a company to come in. The big difference is the workforce, and you need tangible results to show what your workforce and the skill capability is. As Governor Fallon mentioned, one of the things is, okay, well, we may have a high school degree, but they're really reading on the eighth grade level. That's not going to help you. So one of the things that we have done, and I'm proud to say we started this in West Virginia, is we're starting before elementary school in a program called Born Learning that brings the parents and the kids in and teaches the parents how to teach the child before they even go to preschool. How do you sit down and read to the child? How do you, when you have the child in the car and you come to a stop sign, the first day you say, oh, that's a red sign. The second day you say it's got four letters and it's stop, and you keep building on that. So it's an education that's going to take all the way from the very beginning of elementary all the way to high school and postgraduate. But what states have got to be able to do is show the tangible results that we have a workforce that is educated, and it doesn't have to be a bachelor's four-year degree, but a workforce that is educated that can continue to keep the pipeline. I mean, I'll be honest with you, Toyota is a global company, and we started out with 300 members there in Buffalo, 22,000 applicants for the 300 positions, a $400 million investment. We're up to a $1.4 billion investment with 8 expansions, up to 1,500 team members. A company like Toyota is not going to do that if they do not believe that workforce will come in every day, show up every day on time, and build high-quality products. And our technology has changed very much from where it was 17 years ago. So I really do believe the differentiation between the states is going to be the tangible results that you can show for the workforce and the education that they have. And I was honored to be a part of a STEM Council of Governor Tomlin's last year. And as we benchmarked with other states, they clearly showed us that there's tangible results when you can show that workforce and that education makes a difference on which company is going to go to state A versus state B versus state C. So to me, for long term, it's going to be the workforce development.
Okay. She was a very good speaker. She really impressed the whole crowd there. Today's summit provides a comprehensive overview of West Virginia's workforce development efforts and will highlight just a few of the many programs and opportunities that we have in place to train our workforce for the jobs of today and tomorrow. At the end of today's presentation, we will have resources available for anyone who is interested in learning more about the programs discussed today, as well as contact information for each of our speakers. But to kick off today's presentation, I'd like to introduce and welcome my wife, First Lady Joanne Tomblin. As president of Southern West Virginia Community and Technical College for more than 15 years, she's played a hands-on role in the work our state has made to improve workforce training efforts, especially in our state's community college system. So please join me in welcoming First Lady Joanne Tomblin.
Thank you. Well, good afternoon. Well, in 1971, when the West Virginia legislature created an independent community and technical college system, all but three of our community and technical colleges found themselves as components of four-year colleges and universities, non-existent or providing the first 2 years of a four-year college degree. Basically, community colleges offered additional liberal arts programs. And compared to most other states in the country, West Virginia's community and technical college system is still in its infancy when the new system was created about 15 years ago. In the past, our vocational centers, our K-12 system, and our four-year colleges and universities basically lived in silos. But in West Virginia's changing economy, these roles have changed. The emerging workforce needs of all of these entities and others to produce West Virginia's future workforce. And we are now making progress with the help of the Workforce Council. Proudly today, these entities are working together to create apprenticeship programs, seamless pathways to community and technical colleges, and seamless transfer to four-year colleges and universities, enabling students to complete degrees on time. Not only on time, but in a variety of delivery modes, like online, hybrid classes, fast track, simulated workplace, on-site work, or learn and earn, apprenticeship programs, just to name a few. The lifeblood of West Virginia's workforce isn't just the 22-year-old graduating from a four-year college or university anymore. It is also adults being retrained after losing a job, and also their families, or those who may want to start new careers when the industry they work for many years has downsized. The required skills necessary for jobs in West Virginia have evolved from predominantly manual labor to more advanced technical skills. West Virginia's new economy is driving the need for a workforce that is highly skilled, with the ability to reason, analyze, think critically, communicate effectively, and work as teams. Now more than ever, West Virginia's community and technical colleges are critical to meeting the workforce needs of citizens and employers. Community and technical colleges provide the most logical foundation for building broad-based workforce development, which is the key component to economic development. Community and technical colleges have the ability to be market responsive, but leveraging partnerships between them and business and industry, which is a critical component. Resources are limited and will be limited, so partnerships are essential and critical to all those educating and training. Business and industry must play an integral an active role in the development of strategic plans by providing better and more specific data on job needs. Educators are asking employers, what do you need? And now is the time for employers to respond so that appropriate education and training opportunities are available at all levels to help citizens be the workers needed in the Mountain State. Together, we can all move business and industry forward. We've come a long way, but we do have more work to do. As part of our improved coordination with business and industry, the governor has also introduced a new education initiative. It is called My State, My Life. My State, My Life encourages our young people to take advantage of the great opportunities that are being created for them right here in the Mountain State. Nearly 60% of the jobs created in West Virginia through 2018 will require at least a 2-year degree. We need to train our workforce to fill these good-paying jobs in our state's chemical and manufacturing sectors, construction, energy and natural gas industries, healthcare, and education. This video has been shown to thousands of middle school and high school students across the state. From Brook to Logan counties, Morgantown High to Wayne County High School. It has also been showcased by school counselors and private sector organizations, including the Independent Oil and Gas Association. IOGA is now showing the video as part of its Energy Speaks outreach efforts. And we encourage other businesses and associations to partner with us as well. Since the campaign was launched, it has generated nearly 300 Twitter followers, more than 15,000 website visits, and has been promoted on TV, radio, and in the movie theater. We will continue to reach out to students, both traditional and non-traditional, and employers in the coming months to build on the momentum we have already created. And I will tell you, at Southern, we have this video on the front of our website. So let's take a few moments to watch the video that showcases this outstanding program. And I hope each of you will join the governor in sharing this message.
This is my state, West Virginia. It's my home. Some say it's old, some say it's tired. They tell me there's nothing here. Some say it's sad or behind the times, but you know what? They are wrong. This is my state, and this is my life. You think I don't dream? You think I can't succeed? You think I'll repeat the mistakes of others? Amount to nothing? You see me giving up? Well, I don't. These are different times. Change has come to West Virginia. The opportunities for a good life, even a great life, have never been better. I'm talking about jobs, the fastest growing jobs in the state, jobs that are high in demand and need to be filled, good jobs that pay, jobs with a future. There will be 30,000 jobs available every year through 2018. 30,000. That's enough people to fill the Coliseum in Morgantown twice. Nearly 60% of these new jobs will require at least a 2-year degree. And West Virginia has plenty of technical and community colleges to help me succeed, to give me the skills West Virginia employers need, and to match them to good jobs that need to be filled. I can handle at least 2 years, and I can afford it too. So I'm gonna work hard here, get my diploma, and then work harder here, here, or here. I don't need this, this, or this to get in my way. That's old, tired, and sad. And it will stop me from even having a chance to enjoy the new West Virginia. In 2 years or less, I will have the skills needed to design it, build it, fix it, run it, drive it, and get hired, and get paid, and paid really well. Jobs that require a 2-year degree can pay 85% of what jobs that require a 4-year degree pay. And that's a career like this, this, or this. And by 2020, most jobs will require work-ready skills that can be mastered through career and technical education programs. That's opportunity. The opportunity to drive this instead of this. To live here instead of here. The possibilities are endless. It's up to me. I'll put in the work and I'll reap the benefits. This is the new West Virginia. It doesn't matter which path you take. The only thing that matters is that you take one. I have dreams and I know I can succeed. I'm gonna work hard to discover my future in West Virginia. And so can you, because there's a growing need for workers in all kinds of exciting occupations and affordable training and education options all across West Virginia. The opportunity to live a great life in West Virginia has never been better. Learn how to jumpstart your life to a bright future in West Virginia today by visiting mystatemylife.com.
Well, thank you very much, Joanne. You know, West Virginia has experienced a number of challenges, but those days are over. We're overcoming the challenges that we have faced and have a number of success stories to share. And this afternoon, you will hear from a series of speakers representing both the public and private sectors who can speak personally to a number of workforce training programs happening all across the state of West Virginia. Each speaker will also share a short video to allow you to hear directly from West Virginians whose lives have been changed because of our workforce investment efforts. Our first speaker this afternoon, I guess should be their second since Joanne was first, is Dr. Kathy D'Antoni. She's the Chief Officer of Career and Technical Education. Kathy.
Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here. One of West Virginia's greatest resources that must be carefully cultivated is the emerging workforce. This next generation workforce directly impacts West Virginia's future economic success. So to ensure the quality of that emerging workforce, our school system has teamed a very collaborative partnership with business and industries throughout West Virginia. And we together are transforming the traditional career technical education classroom into companies. Across West Virginia, these are called simulated workplaces, but basically what they are companies. The purpose of this is to not only provide students high-level technical skill sets, but to get students to understand business processes. More importantly, what their actions, their individual actions, their attendance, their quality of work, everything that they do inside their company impacts a company's bottom line. Most importantly, these business processes include attendance, time clocks, that's part of the whole protocols of simulated workplace, drug testing. It is mandatory, random drug testing. No one can opt out of it. Also experiences the incorporation of the 5S quality standards that are being used throughout the manufacturing and health industries today. So students are learning what this means and they become part of their companies. These companies are student-led and the company environment develops not only the technical skill sets, but it develops leadership skills, communication skills, team building skills, skill sets that are needed for this student to be successful in tomorrow's workforce. An important aspect of the simulated workplace are the annual business inspections that take place within these companies. Businesses visit these companies once a year. They go in and inspect them, such as a health department would come in and inspect a restaurant. They go in to see, is the environment correct? Is the curriculum right? Is the right equipment working? Do students understand what is going on within that particular company? They talk to the instructor. Is he up to date on the latest technologies or methods that are being used in their industry? Once they inspect it, they send me a report. Where there's a problem, they work with my office to change that curriculum, that classroom, that equipment, to ensure that the students graduating from career technical education in West Virginia has the latest knowledge, the greatest skill sets available for these employers to be able to use when they go to work. I am happy to say that these simulated workplaces are garnering national attention. To date, we have had over 8 states and the country of Australia visit to see what a simulated workplace is in action. And West Virginia is creating quite a buzz at the educational circles in Washington. Right now, our model schools that are set up, we have four model schools right now that they're visiting. One is at Ralph R. Willis in Logan County. One is John D. Rockefeller in Hancock County. One is in Mingo County, Mingo Comprehensive High School. And the one that we just added is in Putnam County at the Putnam Career Tech Center. If ever you are in those areas, I encourage you to stop by and to see firsthand what a simulated workplace looks like and what it feels like. And it is not a curriculum. It is an environment, and these students are unbelievable in what's happening and the leadership that they're taking in their education. They're providing high-level skill sets and understanding of business processes. And one young man that I met at MAVTI Career Tech Center, we were going through the simulated workplace processes, and I looked at him and I said, "Do you understand what we're trying to do with the simulated workplace?" And he said, "Oh, yes, ma'am. You're not preparing us for the next 4 years. You're preparing us for the next 40 years. And out of the mouth of babes, he couldn't have said it better. Today, our next video clip features one of our companies, Cardiac Arrest, which is an automotive company which is named and has a logo at Wood County Tech Center. We interviewed Katie Cleek, who is the foreman of that company. Katie, I know you're here. This is Katie. Katie is the foreman of the company at Wood County Center. And what Katie in this clip talks about one of the protocols of simulated workplace. She talks about the interaction between business and industry and their students or their company employees at Wood County Career Tech Center. Let's take a look.
In a classroom, like, you sit there and you read and you sit there and you wait patiently and you're just, let's move on. You listen to the teacher talk, and down here, you have an interest in what you want to learn. So it's a little bit different because you're interested and the teacher is talking to you. You're taking the information. You're asking questions. If you don't know, you feel more comfortable. And then you have your work and you do more work and you like doing it. And then when you come out in the shop, you're pertaining your knowledge out in the shop. You're getting hands-on. You're getting more knowledge about what you're doing and how you're doing it and doing it the right way. The only thing we don't do, I think, is transmissions. We don't have enough time in our curriculum to learn transmissions, but we do a lot with brakes and tires, a lot of engine work. I mean, as you can see around back here, we are tearing down an engine and putting it back together the right way, how it looks the right way. So that way, when we go to an actual engine in a truck over here, as her example, we took it apart and there was something wrong with it. We noticed it right away and we put it right back together the way it should be. We do alignment machines, and we have special training on the alignment machine. We have a special tech ed teacher from the Hunter Alignment Machine Corporation, and they come in here and they do a one day only, and they teach us about alignment. And then after that, we practice and practice and practice, and eventually just get it right. So we do keep in contact with a lot of businesses, and especially at the end of the year, we'll have special businesses and special people come in, and we have our so-called final. And we go around and we do different type of tests that would count as our final that we have practiced on all year, and that we consider our final in that specific area. And we have one person for each person in the group, and we'll just go around and do it. And if they really like us, then they can offer us a job if they think we're fit with our education. But even at that, like, we have corporations come in all the time, and if they need work or if we need help with something that is specificized in their field, we'll ask questions and we'll work with them on the vehicle. And, you know, if they exceed to like us as well, then they'll offer us a job if they think we could be potentially knowledgeable and worthy of keeping profit.
Well, first of all, thank you, Kathy. And I met Katie a little bit earlier today, and I said, you know, this past weekend I went home and my tiller wouldn't work. If I'd known you were going to be here today, I'd have brought my tiller. I mean, you could have just, she said, that'd be no sweat. Yeah, so anyhow, we're very pleased to have you with us today and for your comments. Absolutely. And now we'll hear from our Chancellor of the Community and Technical College System, Mr. Jim Skidmore, I like to call him. Chancellor.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. And on behalf of Bridge Valley Community and Technical College and the Community College System, welcome to the Advanced Technology Center. And when I mention the Advanced Technology Center, we have new visitors on the campus here. I always answer the burning question all of you have. What are those dogs out there? If you saw them, you're driving in. And I'm sure that you saw those. There's a geese problem in the park. And so George Bossy ran across this idea that the Marriott Corporation uses on their properties where they put up these fake dogs. I'd like to tell you that since this is an advanced technology center that we use lasers and radio waves and whatever to keep those geese away, but nope, just fake dogs. So anyway, well, what I'd like to do this afternoon is I'm going to talk a little bit about what community and technical college are doing in the state to address the workforce needs of our employers, and I want to build up on some of the comments that the First Lady made. There was a time that the community and technical colleges did not offer a great number of technical programs. We offered a large number of allied health programs, but not a lot of the technical programs. But with the increased demand in the technician level occupations, that's those occupations that require education beyond high school but less than a college degree, our community colleges began offering more and more technical programs. In fact, over the last 5 years, we have implemented over 120 different programs, either one-year certificates or associate degrees, for in these technical areas. And more importantly than offering the programs, we've increased the number of graduates in those programs by 31% over that same period of time. So we are putting graduates out to employers to meet that workforce need. Now, a lot of the programs that we've started is centered around manufacturing and the oil and gas sectors. Many of these started with the increased drilling with Marcellus Shale. And we have worked with companies to develop new programs, develop curriculum, and some of those things that we have started advanced manufacturing programs, like we have in this particular facility, an advanced manufacturing technician program that was started really for Toyota, but it's expanded to other companies now. Also, mechatronics, high-level industrial maintenance programs, chemical process technology for the chemical industry, both here and in the Mid-Ohio Valley, petroleum technology, North Central West Virginia, Northern Panhandle, Pierrepont, West Virginia Northern, and then instrumentation programs, instrumentation techs, they're needed everywhere, oil and gas, manufacturing, everywhere. We talk to employers, we need instrumentation technicians. And also, we just last week in this room here, we had a meeting with the oil and gas companies, midstream companies, on implementing a gas measurement technology program and discussed a corrosion technology program. These are programs we haven't done before, folks. Because of the oil and gas industry, we're stepping forward and working with employers to develop these type of programs to meet their workforce needs. Now, the good part about these, they were designed with employer input, and with the assistance of the governor and the legislature, we've been fortunate that we've been able to develop some really strong employer partnerships where we've had some public dollars to leverage private dollars. And you're going to hear in a minute about the Learn and Earn program. It's one of those programs that we've leveraged public dollars to get some private dollars. But also these companies have stepped forward and they have provided us internships for our students. They've provided job placement for our students. They've actually provided us adjunct faculty members, you know, to teach in our courses, and they've also donated equipment, and they've also donated money, just like with this facility here. You see out the name of the building is Toyota Hall. That's because of a donation that Toyota Corporation made to Bridge Valley to maintain the high-tech equipment in this facility. So we've had partners, employer partners, that have stepped up to help us with our particular programs, and that's been critically important. The other thing that has given us a boost, we were fortunate enough to secure a $25 million grant from the Department of Labor, and this has helped us push forward some of these technical programs in those particular areas of energy and manufacturing, and it's also has enabled us to implement a sector-based approach to workforce development, which means that we get those sectors of companies together, identify their needs, and then we meet their workforce needs either through what we do, the baccalaureate institutions, career technical centers. So it's an idea that we bring groups of employers together. Also in that grant, and you're going to hear from Steve in a minute, it has a partnership with apprenticeship affiliated trades. So when we're able to leverage those type of resources, either from partners, employers, or federal grants, it pushes our agenda at a faster pace. Now, in closing, I'd like to mention there's about what we're doing for dislocated coal miners. And as the governor mentioned earlier, that's critical to the state of West Virginia that we address those individuals who've been dislocated. And three of the colleges that are located in the geographic area of where most of the dislocated coal miners live, and that's Southern, of course, Southern West Virginia Community Technical College, Williamson, Logan, Boone County. This college here, Bridge Valley, Kanawha County, there's a fairly large number of dislocated miners in Kanawha County, and also New River Community Technical College down in the Beckley area. We're going to put together an accelerated EMI program, electromechanical instrumentation program, that will allow those individuals to get the skills and build upon the current skills they have as a miner. And that will enable them to qualify for jobs in the oil and gas industry, manufacturing, and the chemical industry. Also, there's going to start a program here at this facility accelerated program chemical operators. Dow, some other companies in the Valley, they need chemical operators. So we're going to start a new program. We currently have a program here that runs at night, but we're going to run this program in the day, and it's going to be accelerated. And this will enable dislocated workers to get the skills that they can get a job, and they'll get a wage that'll be somewhat similar to what they're used to making, in the coal mines, because these are high-wage, high-skill jobs. And we're moving forward with doing that because I said it's critical. One last little note, if it's your first trip to the Advanced Technology Center, and I know some of you have been here several times, but if this is your first trip and you'd like to have a tour, I didn't ask Dr. Harris about this, but I'll volunteer Bridge Valley folks to give you a tour of the building. So after our meeting today, if you want to have a tour of the building and see some of the equipment, some of the things we're doing, you're welcome to do that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jim. And if you haven't been here, I would take him up on that offer. It's pretty amazing, some of the equipment and some of the things going on here in this facility. At this time, before I introduce you, I'd just like to say that, when we talk to especially larger employer or potential employers, and I'm usually around the table when Keith brings these people in, but when you're looking at a half a billion or a billion or maybe a $4 billion investment, one of the questions that the investors always have is, do you have a big enough workforce in West Virginia to handle this kind of a job? And I said, yeah, and our answer is yes. If we don't have it, we'll get it. And that's one of the good things about working with Steve White. Steve, as you know, is from the Affiliated Construction Trades Foundation. He's going to speak about their apprentice programs. But, in a recent encounter we had with a major business, when you look at our workforce and our borders and so forth, sometimes we don't always have the number of people we need inside our borders to do a major construction job like this. However, by working with Steve and others, we look at the region to pull those people in, just as our people in West Virginia with these particular skills travel across to Ohio or Pennsylvania or Virginia. You know, those employees do the same thing here in West Virginia. We are small, and that's one of our disadvantages, but it's also one of our advantages of being here. But anyhow, it's a group that really plays a main role, and especially the construction and other things in West Virginia are the trades. And I've learned to have a great deal of respect for the amount of training, the kind of training that these individuals have in order to complete these very complicated projects that they're asked to do. So at this time, I'll ask Steve White to give his presentation. Steve.
Thank you, Governor, and it's an honor to be here at this forum and to be with so many distinguished guests. And so I want to talk just very briefly about apprenticeship from really two different angles. One, let's just talk a little bit about what is apprenticeship. It's a method of training that combines, it's simple, combines on-the-job training with classroom training. And as simple as that may be, we should just think about it for a minute. I mean, we're used to traditional classroom training, maybe more like the simulated workforce where they're in the classroom and doing simulating a workplace. So we just take it the next step. You're on the job for a 2 to 5 year period of time, depending on the craft, and then you're going and taking related classroom training, either in the evenings, could be on a Saturday, it could be for a week period of time. I work with a number of different programs, and there's a variety of ways to do that. So apprenticeship is this unique method of mixing. It's not the four-year degree method, but it is a way to get a highly skilled, highly trained workforce, mixing that classroom training with on-the-job training, and it's effective. So apprenticeship is a model that works. It's being talked a lot about for more than construction. I will talk about construction because that's what I know about, but also think about how can it expand beyond construction? Because, again, it's a method that works. It's proven results. I think there's going to be some federal funds available to help expand apprenticeship, so we should be thinking about that as we move forward. Next slide, please. I realize when I have these slides that it's way too small information. If there's one thing to get from the slide and from the next couple that I have, there's a website.
It's wvapprenticeships.com. WVApprenticeships.com.
So that's most of my information is found on that website. This is just a map and listing of, there's 29 different, I'm talking about construction craft apprenticeship facilities in the state. They cover the entire state, kind of like a sales geography, but you can see that they're located mostly in the northern part of the state. Many of them are statewide facilities. 29 facilities, 13 different crafts. We're talking about boilermakers, brick layers, electricians, carpenters, plumbers, pipe fitters, et cetera. Next slide, please. At the website, sorry for the little type and the detail. Point is, there's a website out there, West Virginia, or wvapprenticeships.com. You can go to, and the tab up in the middle is to help people figure out, find a program for them. So it says, find a program. Next slide, please. It'll just show you a map. In the center, Kanawha County. If you hit Kanawha County, again, next slide, please. It would just simply show, here's all the programs for the crafts for Kanawha County, and you could do that for any counties. For those of you from different counties, you want to know what apprenticeships are available for your particular region. The website will help you do that. So it's a way of helping get the information out about different apprenticeship. In our world, apprenticeship is, first of all, it's a private sector initiative. We get very little state or federal dollars, occasionally a grant. We're fortunate enough, as Mr. Skidmore said, to work with community colleges, and that's a great initiative because we're trying to marry up, if you will, apprenticeship with a degree. You get a certificate from the federal government, by the way, for apprenticeship completion. It's a regulated a course of study. But we're looking to even get more credentialing involved because that's important to employers and prospective employers. But anyway, this talks about what I'm showing here is every county has got coverage for every craft, and so people are interested. In our world, it's very important that the students understand the craft that they're interested in. Through the website, we get a lot of people who are saying, I'm interested in construction. Well, I got to know in order to help someone, are you want to be a carpenter, or do you want to be a painter, or do you want to be a pipe fitter? If they say, I want to be a welder, everybody wants to be a welder. Well, I have seven crafts that do welding. Boilermakers, pipe fitters, iron workers. So, you know, there's craft awareness is something that we've talked a lot to the vocational schools about. That's why I like their simulated workplace, gets people thinking about what's it going to take to be, what do they like to do? We're the private sector. We don't want to invest a lot of money in people and then find out they didn't want to do it. So apprenticeship is a system that's been around, that works well, that is an alternative, if you will, to the four-year, nothing against the four-year degree, but it might not be for everybody, is a formalized course of study regulated by the federal government. So what do I mean by that? You could just say, well, I'm just going to hire someone and call my apprentice. No. It actually has to be a formalized course of study that has a progression, minimum hours, 144 hours a year of that classroom training. Have to go through certain phases of on-the-job training. You just can't be a drywaller or a ceiling person for your entire apprenticeship because that's not a career. That's just a simple, you know, that's a one part of a career. You need to be well-rounded in your field so that you can be employable throughout your career. So that's another important part about apprenticeship. This is a jointly administered program. By that I mean it's labor and management. In our world, I'm talking just about the construction side. What does that mean? That means that together, that's the oversight of the program. It's about how many people get taken in, about what the curriculum will look like. So that's very important to the success of apprenticeship programs because if you're going to be working, you know, you have to have a job, you have to have employers. And we work with over 1,000 employers in the state who employ then these apprentices. An apprentice will want to work with many different employers over their apprenticeship period because that's how they get a well-rounded education. There's a progression back to the regulatory. You start out at usually 40% or 50% of what a journey worker or journeyman worker would make, and then you work your way up over a period of time, kind of a building block approach, not unlike a college. It's tough for us. It's interesting. When the governor said big companies come, they've got a $4 billion facility. Can you get enough people? I'll always say yes, by the way, just to be honest. I will always say yes. Keith said, well, what if we get two of them? Yes. You know.
Yes.
It's a challenge. And in our industry, you know, construction is very cyclical, up and down. It's very hard to predict, hard for the employers and the workers to decide how many to take in. You know, because we can't just stack them up and let them sit around waiting. They need to go to work. So it's a challenge, but it's something that we've worked hard on. We work well with employers, and we're working more and more, and I think this is important, and your leadership is important here, Governor, and there's more that needs to be done about integrating from the vocational school to the apprenticeship to the community college or the baccalaureate degrees. There's a lot of work that could be done there, too. So anyway, I hope I've given you a little bit about apprenticeship. We have a video here to show, which is really, the video is public broadcasting was trying to do career awareness. Great. We're on board with that. Great idea. One of their subjects was a young a pipe fitter, a plumber. Plumber pipe fitting is a combined occupation. The purpose of this was to talk about STEM or STEAM, however you want to use it. Why do I need math in school? You know. And so that was the purpose of this, but it also is a great introduction, you know, from our point of view to get into apprenticeship. So we're going to show the video, and thank you very much for allowing me to participate.
It's very intriguing when I go in to any big building, a school or a hospital, and now I have an understanding of the system that is there and what's hidden behind the walls and what's moving around people, and they have no idea that it's there. My name is Matthew McGinnis. I am from Fairmont, West Virginia, and I'm a second-year apprentice in the Plumbers and Pipefitters Union based out of Morgantown, West Virginia. I was looking to get into a trade because I enjoy working with my hands and physical things. And I have family members that are in other trades. I have an uncle who is an electrician. And I spoke to him about getting into the trades, and he actually told me that this one was a good one to get into. Well, as an apprentice, we have in-school work two nights a week. We come for a few hours in the evening. And then we also have on-the-job training, where we're basically kind of a shadow. You know, we go with someone that is already a journeyman, that has been in the trade for a while, and we follow them so that we can learn from them. They pass down their knowledge to us, and it helps to actually be able to see and do the things as opposed to just be told about them. At the end of the day, when everybody's packing up to go home, I can turn and look over my shoulder and I can actually see what I have done. And I know that in the future, it's actually going to be utilized for something. It's going to perform some action that is going to benefit someone in some way. And that means a lot to me. You know, as a kid, I didn't think that I would need from a math or a science class. Well, I'm not going to need to know how to do it. I'll never use it in everyday life. But weight and pressure and temperature and volume, all those words that I heard in class when I was going through school as a kid are all things that I hear now. You can use a triangle to figure out how to move one piece of a round pipe from point A to point B. And I never would have assumed that when I was learning it to begin with. But now it's a crucial part of what I do.
Okay, well, today we are going to use the Pythagorean theorem to determine the length of a copper pipe that we need to go between two 45 degree angles to offset our pipe from one line to another, staying parallel.
If our pipe was coming in, it was going to run into something, so we needed to offset it. We want to keep it parallel and move it a certain distance, but a lot of times we'll try to avoid using a 90 degree angle because it restricts the flow more. So we use a 45, it's easier for it to flow. So we really weren't creating any angles. The angles are already there. All we're actually just figuring out the measurement for this piece. Now, for sides A and B of our triangle, our pipes are measured out 3 inches side to side, 6 inches end to end. So we're going to use these for our sides A and B to figure out side C, our hypotenuse, and get the length of our pipe to finish our project.
It can be hard work at times. You can be doing simple plumbing with, you know, small copper pipe, and it doesn't take a lot of physical effort. Or you could be working with a 10-inch steel pipe that you couldn't physically lift on your own, and you have to use a chain fall or a crane or some type of machine to lift. And you are constantly exerting yourself throughout the day.
So now we have our numbers in place, we can start our math. Now, 6 squared. 36. 3 squared is 9. Now we add our numbers together, 36 and 9 will give us 45. And now we have 45 equals c squared. So in order to figure out our actual value, we'll have to take the square root of 45, and that'll give us the value of c, which will give us the length of pipe that we need to complete our project.
You have to find what you enjoy doing, what at the end of the day you don't regret. You want to show up the next day and you want to do it. And this trade is that for me.
I don't know, Steve. I think I'll stick with this governor's gig here. Our next speaker is Todd Fox. He's from DuPont, and he's going to speak about the Learn and Earn program, and he'll be followed by a video from a participant in Toyota's incredibly successful apprenticeship program. So, Todd, you're up.
Excuse me. Hi, everybody. I wanted me to talk a little bit about the Learn and Earn program. And the guys I work with probably haven't heard this, but we're getting ready, obviously DuPont's getting ready to spin off into two companies. So we've been having some meetings around that. And actually back in 2012, when we started the Learn and Earn program, we had the same meetings. That's when we realized that we had an aging workforce. First quarter of 2012. So we talked through that, and then WEP came to us with a proposal for the Learn and Earn program, which was good timing with the aging workforce we were dealing with that year. So it was good timing to get them started. The program itself, to date, we've ran 42 people through the program. We have two more cohorts. The program's backed by the governor's grant system. We get 50% reimbursement, so the employee comes to the plant. We pay the wages, and then we get a 50% reimbursement on their wages. The cycle of the program, the college, WP, does a three-month classroom training event. It's based off CAP material, Center for Application of Process Technology. It was built by the Gulf Coast Engineering Network, modern training, video-based training. 3 months, they come to the plant. We do a three-month work rotation where we actually put them out on the plant floor with an on-the-job trainer. They spend that time learning the job, working the job, go through our safety systems, our safety equipment, understand that. Excuse me. They go back to the school for another three-month rotation where the training gets a little more advanced, gets more into detailed instrumentation and some higher advanced skills. They come back to the plant for another 3 months. At that point, they're really deep into the job. We bring them right back into the same job they spent the first 3 months in, so they learn more about the job. Been very successful. I made some notes here. We've actually hired two direct employees, technician employees from the program, so they didn't even come in as operators, came in as technicians with their skill levels. We've hired 18 operators, chemical operator, process operators into the plant. We know by talking to them, they still, even after graduating the program, they still have to come through our hiring process where we have some additional testings, and we actually do a hands-on skill demonstration. So we actually test the schooling system to make sure that they learned the skills that they were teaching them with a hands-on assessment. Very successful, all great students. And they stay in contact with us, even though we're not in a position to hire. We still talk to them. They still stay in contact with us. So just from us, Michelle could probably talk to it, but from our side, we know there's been at least four others hired by different companies. So very high-skilled students. Yeah, I made one other note as I've listened to everybody. We've actually had two in the program that partway through, after coming to the plant for the first rotation and seeing how the jobs worked and all the different jobs in the plant, they actually fell out of the program because once they were there, they seen some other jobs, positions we had in the plant that were a little more interesting to them. So give them the opportunity, you know, to get into a big manufacturing facility, see what was available. One of them started into a chemistry degree, kind of fell out of that, thought this Learn and Earn was a good option. Once he got in there and understood how that position worked in a manufacturing facility, decided that was his route. So he actually fell out of the program, went back to school to finish his chemistry degree. So very successful program. I just talked to Michelle a few minutes before I started. The big thing now is with the spinoff to two companies, now we're going to have two companies working with the program. So we're working through that to understand how that'll work. DuPont wants to stay with Learn and Earn program, and I'm moving to the new company. So I'm tasked with working with Michelle to get the Learn and Earn program set up with the new company as well. With that, the next video, going to hear from Cody Cunningham. He's a student in the Toyota Incredible Successful Apprentice Program, another way we're helping people enter our workforce. Thank you.
My name is Cody Cunningham, and I'm currently enrolled in the AMT program. I attend classes here at Bridge Valley, as well as work part-time at Toyota Motor Manufacturing West Virginia, located in Buffalo. I'm here today to talk to you about my time in the program and the experiences it has offered me. Before I started this program, I didn't know much about manufacturing cars or powertrains. However, after starting the AMT program, I quickly began to learn. This program is well coordinated between what the school offers and exactly what the manufacturing industry needs in a skilled technician. I attend classes 2 days a week that include fluid power, consisting of both pneumatics and hydraulics, programmable logic controllers, mechanical design, manufacturing processes, and electronics technology. These are just a few of the classes I've taken within a two-year period of learning and training. There are many benefits of attending Bridge Valley as a partner school for this cooperative program. The most beneficial being the Advanced Technology Center and its resources, which allow us to have valuable in-class teachings that directly relate to our work. The hands-on learnings the AMTs within the program gain from using modules and trainers here at the ATC are invaluable tools. During classes, there's a professional atmosphere that is upkept and supported by the staff each and every class day. This furthers our professionalism in and outside the plant. I am thankful for the support of the teaching staff and the administrators who make the Advanced Technology Center a great place to learn. As I've mentioned before, I attend classes 2 days a week, and the other 3 days a week, I work on the plant floor gaining valuable knowledge of manufacturing at a world-class manufacturer. This is where I get to apply what I've learned in class and actually use it in a real manufacturing environment. I learn about everything from troubleshooting programmable logic controllers to changing out motors for a machine axis. The knowledge I obtain from the experience and skilled maintenance technicians I work with on the floor will continue to guide me through the rest of this program and future jobs I might have thanks to this program and the guidance of both Bridge Valley and Toyota Motor Manufacturing West Virginia. I believe this program sets a foundation for many more programs just like it. And with those programs, I hope many more manufacturers jump at the thought of sponsoring students to gain crucial knowledge along with valuable training in the manufacturing industry. With programs like this, we can begin to close the tremendous gap of jobs needed in the skilled technician field. With the support of many more partner schools and guidance of manufacturing companies, we can begin to do just that. Thank you all for your time and your support of the AMT program.
Thank you, Todd, and thanks to DuPont for being a part of this program. I think it's an excellent idea, and I know it's been very successful for Toyota. So, and now we'll hear from our Adjutant General, Jim Hoyer, of the West Virginia National Guard, who'll speak about the Mountaineer Challenge Academy and highlight just a few of the many programs available to help our veterans transition back in to our workforce. General.
So thank you, Governor. A little bit of background. Well, why is the Adjutant General here? I am military guys. So I have three primary initiatives that the Governor tasked me to make sure that the National Guard is able to do. Number one is to be ready to go serve our nation overseas and make sure that our folks are as capable as possible to go do that mission and come home to their families safely. Number two is to be prepared to respond to the needs of our citizens. And unfortunately for the Governor and I, we've had a lot of experience at that. But I would say that most people would say that we've been pretty damn good at it. And I think the people would say that. But number three is use the National Guard to be a catalyst for making West Virginia a better place. And that's part of what our role in this is. Now, the first two require education and training. And in 1996, the Governor, along with his former colleague, Oshel Crago, were the catalyst for creating a tuition reimbursement program for the West Virginia National Guard. And what does that mean for us? Today, that means that 78% of the 6,500 men and women in the West Virginia National Guard fall in one of four categories. They're either in college or trade education, or they've completed college or trade education. That's pretty remarkable. Pretty remarkable for us as a state and our organization. And that's why when we respond to something and they do it so well, that's why these men and women are so capable. So let me give you a couple other things that we're doing on that third component. I'll give you one reactive example and two proactive examples. The first is we had to deal with a platform transition at the 167th Airlift Wing from C-5s, which is one of the most maintenance-intense aircraft in the inventory, to a C-17, a more modern aircraft. And it was about survival of the unit. If we stayed in C-5s, C-5s were going to go away, the unit was going to go away. So we made the decision that we had to transition knowing that we were going to have to do a reduction in force for 166 federal technicians. But with a partnership with the community and technical college system, other partners in the state, to include a private institution, University of Charleston, we created a program to transition those 166 people to other opportunities in the state of West Virginia, from cyber to mechatronics to CDL licenses, to create opportunities for those 166 people to stay in West Virginia. That's a reactive piece, but what about proactive? A couple of things that we're doing. There are approximately 90,000 people just in the United States Army alone that are going to be reduced out of the force over the next couple of years. What better pool for us to go after than those men and women who may have 10 years of service but still want to serve? Let's bring them to West Virginia and put them in the National Guard. But you can't do that if you don't have a job opportunity for them outside the National Guard. So we're actively working to go recruit those folks using the governor's workforce initiative construct. And in about less than 30 days, we're going to Fort Bragg, North Carolina, one of the largest military bases in the world. And we're going down with a series of employers, and we're going to say, hey, come join the National Guard, come take advantage of our workforce program, and be a viable part of our state. There are also a lot of men and women who have reached 20 years of service, who have a pretty good retirement, but still want to continue to work. What better group to bring to West Virginia than those people that you can put to work who also have that additional disposable income to spend in our economy? So we're going to actively go after that group of folks as well. The last piece is Mountaineer Challenge Academy. And it's a phenomenal program. It's been a good program over the years, but in the last couple of years, we've taken it to the next level. So this is a program where at-risk youth make their own decision, along with their families, to go to a 22-week military-style curriculum. And now, thanks to the efforts of the governor and the first lady and our partners throughout state government, if you meet the requirements at the end of the 22 weeks, you can get your high school diploma awarded from the home high school in which you had dropped out of school. So right now we're averaging with a diploma option about 137 kids. About 80% of those achieve their diploma. The balance 20% go back into the school system. Our goal, as directed to me by the governor, is to get our numbers up where we're consistently within about 18 months putting 150 kids per class, 300 kids per year, taking them from high school dropout either back into school or to a high school diploma. But the high school diploma is not good enough. So the next phase of what we've got to do and what we're going to press for are all those initiatives within the governor's workforce plan, from apprenticeship programs to two-year degrees to 70% of the kids who receive the diploma from the task, and their task test score is high enough that they're eligible for the Promise Scholarship. As one young man pointed out to me, and he became our spokesman for the program, he said, "General, this is not a place for bad kids. This is a place for kids who made bad choices." And that's what we're going to be about as an organization. The last thing I'll leave you with is a video of a young lady who's talking about what that education program has meant to the state of West Virginia. And a couple things I'll tell you about Katie. One is she's a fluent Spanish speaker, so when you host a Peruvian military delegation along with the ambassador, you've got a translator. And they were extremely impressed that this young lady was doing the translation. Number two, if you're a proud, old, aging Special Forces guy and you still think you're in pretty good shape, don't get on the treadmill next to Katie in the gym. She will make you look bad. But Katie, I think, kind of summarizes what our education program has been about and what we're trying to do in the National Guard.
I joined the West Virginia National Guard because they have 100% paid tuition assistance. I come from a large family. I was attending an out-of-state school. Financially, it made a lot of sense. Besides having tuition paid for, I also earned a paycheck and was able to attend college and serve my community and my nation. I've gained military skills that directly correspond with my degree, and that's given me valuable experience to make me more competitive in the civilian workforce. And now it's exciting to see that the West Virginia National Guard is providing educational opportunities to our state's at-risk youth through the Mountaineer Challenge Academy. Military and civilian real-world experience combined with a college degree, that's all there is to it, West Virginia National Guard.
Thank you, General, for all you do to help lead our future generation. And our final speaker, well, actually not. She's next to the final speaker, but the next speaker is Dr. Carolyn Stewart. She's the director of the Herbert Henderson Office of Minority Affairs. And Dr. Stewart will share how the DHHR's TANF program helped her throughout her inspirational journey and how we are working to encourage others to take a very similar path. She's my hero, Dr. Stewart.
Good afternoon. It is my pleasure and my honor to be here today and contribute in a small way as we highlight the great work regarding workforce development that is taking place in West Virginia. I want to take just a few minutes to share a little of my personal story with you about one of the programs that is available, but may not be widely thought of as workforce development. It is now known as TANF, Temporary Assistance for Needy Families, but it was aid to families with dependent children when I was able to benefit from the program. I completed the ninth grade, entered into the 10th grade, quit school, and then discovered that I could get a GED. With that discovery, I took personal responsibility to do just that. However, I thought that was as far as I could go. But it was during a visit to a friend who worked for vocational rehabilitation that I learned I could go to college. As I began to take some initiative to educate myself about various possibilities to learn and grow, the rehab worker began to assist me more and more. I know some of you know that's what we do in West Virginia. I enrolled in a 2-year degree program at Bluefield State College, and it was there that a counselor worked with me on discovering the employment opportunities that were available right here in West Virginia. Through personal responsibility, perseverance, and mainly support from various state agencies, I was able to go from a GED to a PhD to the governor's office. Is West Virginia not great? It has been quite some time since my workforce journey began, and I had to go to numerous places to get the assistance I needed for a successful journey. Today, the journey has been simplified. You have the luxury of being able to access information and support in one location. Governor Tomblin has worked diligently with his Workforce Planning Council to ensure that any West Virginian who wants to go to work in the Mountain State can do just that. As all of the agencies that make up the council have the same mission, to develop the best workforce that we can and keep our citizens working in our great state. The Department of Health and Human Resources is making changes to TANF, and these changes will help more people follow a path similar to mine. Through TANF, West Virginia Works provides a variety of employment-related services such as training assistance, occupational skills development, job search support, and child care assistance. Thanks to changes passed by the legislature this year, the TANF sanction process can become policy driven. Benefit flexibility can be established for those who need and want to improve employment opportunities through education and/or training programs. West Virginia policy can change when the federal policy changes, allowing consistency in federal funding for the program. Family stability will increase when parents are better prepared to enter the job market and are able to access higher level skilled jobs. And with those higher skills and opportunities for gainful employment, reliance on government assistance decreases and self-sufficiency increases. As you will see in this video, the program already is benefiting people.
Well, at the time I was getting divorced, and it was a bad situation, so I left with the kids and what I could fit in the car, and I went to the Department of Health and Human Resources to see exactly what options would be available to a single mother that had no prior work history to work with. They explained the program to me and all the benefits of how they, you know, can help you with your resume building and interview skills and different things. So I decided to go ahead and enroll in that so that I could get a foot in the door and try to get started with a good profession. Well, first of all, they give you the option, if you're not employed when you first enroll, in order to receive any of the cash assistance or the other programs that they have available through the TANF program, you have to be enrolled in a work activity, which they give you the option to volunteer or to go to the adult education program, which is called the Spokes program. So I figured since I had some college experience, I had a few college credits, so I went ahead and enrolled in the Spokes program because I thought that would probably help me get employed faster, whereas if I was just volunteering at the soup kitchen or something like that, I might not be able to, you know, get to as many interviews or have those opportunities open up quite as fast. Like I said, I was enrolled in the Spokes program there, and actually a couple of the ladies that run that are affiliated with the RESA 6, who also is affiliated with the Marshall County and High County schools, and they helped me prepare for the secretary exam in Marshall County is where I started. Once I got hired through Marshall County, I was able to bring my test results to High County as well, and then substitute in both counties until I got on full time. Actually, prior to passing that test through the Spokes program, they did set me up with an interview for the AT&T customer call center, and I spent 10 months there while I was preparing to take the secretary exam. Honestly, if any parent out there, whether you're a single parent or a two-parent household, if you've lost your job or if you're in a bad situation, this is absolutely the program I would recommend. If you have small children, not only do they help you with a small monthly income, but they also help you with transportation reimbursement. If you have vehicle problems, they'll repair your vehicle. They help with clothing and vision and dental services. They'll help you with your car insurance. So basically, any barrier that you could think of that would present a problem with becoming employed, there's an avenue that they can help you get through that.
Well, thank you, Dr. Stewart, for your presentation. And please join me in thanking all of today's participants, including our speakers and those on the video. I just want to say that these six programs are just an overview of our efforts to strengthen and train our workforce for the jobs that we're creating. And in addition, we're striving to promote innovation in form of entrepreneurship and advanced technology through initiatives such as the Microsoft IT Academy. Moving forward with the help of the National Governors Association, we plan to be a national leader in initiatives called Sector Strategies, which will serve as our cornerstone to our workforce efforts in the coming years. As part of this initiative, our community and technical college system is already working with local economic development officials businesses and business and education leaders, and members of local communities to gain insight into workforce needs specific to the 8 regions of our state. And through these efforts, we're positioning West Virginia as a national leader in creative ways to meet workforce demands. Now, as many of us know, our road in life is not always a straight shot. In addition to our workforce development efforts, we have a number of other programs in place to help people get back on the right track if they run into challenges and struggles along the way. Last month, I signed into law the Comprehensive Juvenile Justice Reform for West Virginia. And soon, there will be 25 truancy diversion specialists in all 55 counties to provide early intervention services to those children who need them most, keeping our kids in the classroom and out of the courtroom. We've also worked to tackle our state's substance abuse epidemic. With more rehabilitation and treatment facilities than ever before, we're helping those struggling with addiction get the care and services they need to overcome their addictions and start the path toward recovery. And starting this week, the Governor's Advisory Council on Substance Abuse will meet again across the state to discuss the next steps in these efforts. All the while, through our justice reinvestment efforts, we've worked to reduce prison overcrowding, taken steps to rehabilitate our inmates, and give them every opportunity to become productive members of our society again. These are all important initiatives that we give West Virginians the best opportunity to overcome in their trials and return their families to and communities and their workplaces. So to conclude our presentation today, I'd like to welcome Commerce Secretary Keith Burdett, who will share with you how he and his team at the Development Office use these programs in the field to promote the Mountain State to businesses and industries across the country and around the globe. So Keith, you're up.
Thank you, Governor. First of all, let me apologize in advance. The First Lady and I, in our spare time, have served as pollen magnets, and I've been. Those of you who haven't got allergies can thank me later. I have all of them now. But I also want to thank the Governor for hosting this event and to create a message about what West Virginia is doing in workforce development. I have said often in the last 4 years that West Virginia has a great story to tell. We don't always tell it well, and this is a great opportunity to tell it well. And if you really don't know what West Virginia is doing towards workforce development and training, you really don't have to look any farther than this building. This is the kind of image that we're now portraying to other companies. We bring them here. This is the one place where we can show them in bricks and mortar what we're doing in programming all over the state of West Virginia. And it is making a difference. As Secretary of Commerce, I oversee a wide variety of agencies, and they all play an important role in the lives of West Virginians. But none are more important than our efforts to attract new investment and jobs to our state. That's what this is all about. The West Virginia Development Office is the state's sales team. I say it often, I am a salesman. I take great pride in that. Our mission and that of the mission of the men and women who work in the Development Office is to tell companies every day why West Virginia is the right place to grow their businesses. And while the work can be challenging and require patience and persistence, I have found a passion in not just that office, but from the governor down towards advancing this cause, advancing the mission that West Virginia is the right place to do business. And it truly, you can see it, has become a labor of love. Now, the elevator version of our pitch is pretty simple. We've made fundamental changes in the operation of our state over actually multiple governors and multiple legislators and Republicans and Democrats. We've made fundamental changes in our state's tax system. We are now a leader in the region and competitive around the country. We've reduced corporate rates. We've eliminated business franchise taxes. We've developed competitive credits to encourage investment. We've privatized workers' compensation and gone from some of the highest rates in the country to some of the lowest. We've stabilized our employment funds, trust funds, so that unlike most states, we weren't forced to borrow funds from the federal government to pay basic benefits. A cost, by the way, that ultimately gets passed on to employers in those states that did. We have one of the strongest cash reserves and rainy day funds in the country, which protects businesses from being the targets when we need to balance the budget. We've tackled our long-term debts, including our pensions and post-employment benefits, all of which are fragmented costs that somehow get passed into the bigger tax sphere. We have lowered the cost of doing business in West Virginia to 14% now below the national average from multiple surveys. Our cost of living is 14% below the national average. Our cost of commercial electric is 22% below the national average. Steve Spence said this morning, he said who is the director of the international office, he said, for 30 years, I have been telling people West Virginia is the place to be. And it's finally true. We've made the fundamental changes. We have a positive story to tell. But the end of the story has yet to be written. And that's what brings us here today. We have one more challenge to tackle. Making sure that we have a competitive, highly skilled, reliable, drug-free workforce for those that do business in West Virginia. When we do visits with in-state companies or those that we wish to attract, I will tell you workforce issues are number one, number two, and number three on their list of questions. And if it wasn't clear before, let it be clear today. Governor Tomlin understands that. And his message, I can promise you, has resonated throughout his entire administration. I've said this before, and I have to change the wording because my staff get all worked up when I use this phrase, but I always tell the story about the governor. When people ask how serious it is, I said, when the governor reorganized the Workforce Planning Commission, he replaced almost everyone on it. Now, I usually use the term fired, but I don't. But he replaced the people on it because he was ready to take responsibility for it himself. And he wanted to make sure that the right people that could make decisions were in place. So he issued that command performance order to all of us, all of the decision makers he thought were within his administration who had some connection or some responsibility for workforce development, to serve and to be present. No surrogates, no stand-ins. We were expected to be there because, ladies and gentlemen, he was there every single meeting. It's a step that the experts at the National Governors Association says every state in the union ought to pay attention to. It is the right model to advance the country's most critical need. He is insisting on coordination. He is fighting duplication. He expects a product that has value to both our citizens and our employers. And as the salesman I referred to earlier, I can tell you it is working. Our recruitments know that a key component of our incentives is a coordinated workforce training plan that addresses both immediate needs and longer-term needs. They know that Workforce West Virginia, our community and technical colleges, and even our vocational programs in West Virginia's public schools can give them an immediate inventory of potential employees who have skills that they need. They know that the community and technical college system will design skill programs for those who have the aptitude, but may require more training. They know that the governor's guaranteed workforce training program will give them training funds that can be applied in the most flexible of fashions, maybe as flexible as any workforce training programs anywhere in the country, to either train employees, train trainers, or even, yes, as was the case with two recent graduates of WVU, send them to Pietro Fiorentini's plant in Italy, tough gig, so that they could be ready to open the plant in the Northern Panhandle 4 months later. It's an equation that has worked in the recruitment of a few companies with names you may know. Macy's, Gestamp, oh yeah, and there's this new one, Procter & Gamble. It's helped expand Hino and Toyota and American Woodmark. In fact, in 4 years, Governor, it's resulted in $8 billion plus in new investments, 11,000 plus jobs in 20 different industry categories. And yes, we've done it all for a reason, because we know how important it is to our state and its future. It can help your company, too. It can help your communities as well. If you're not here from a company, you need to help be the ambassadors to spread this news. There are a wide variety of programs that will get the job done for your company. All you have to do is ask. You have our attention. I promise you, it is the number one priority within our recruitment efforts, is to make sure that we can go out and sell the really important thing to businesses across this country, and that is we have not just a skilled training workforce, but the best skilled trained workforce in America. Not just that they will show up for work, but they will be committed to the companies that will employ them and treat them fairly. That's the message. That's what this is all about. That's what this building is about. That's what these programs are about. That's what the mission of this governor has been about. So today, as we conclude, I will tell you that the work is just beginning. Progress has been made, but we need to do more. And you have to be part of doing the rest with us. If you haven't engaged, I encourage you, take the phone numbers, the email addresses, the contacts, pick up the phone with suggestions, questions, ideas. We're an open book. We're waiting for you. We are waiting for you to join us in the fight to make West Virginia one in every workforce-related category. Thank you all very, very much for being here and for allowing me to participate for a few minutes in today's program.
Well, thank you very much, Keith. We appreciate that. Hope your allergies get better. I hope I don't get them. You know, earlier in the afternoon, the first clip we showed was of Millie Marshall. And later in that meeting, I thought it was something that pretty funny that as we were sitting around with other governors, but we shared Millie Marshall's story. But during that same meeting, there was another exceptionally positive moment in that meeting, and a true statement to our ongoing workforce development efforts. There's a new governor from Rhode Island, and after Millie had finished her presentation, Millie said, how could Rhode Island get a Toyota plant? And Millie responded, said, you need to do what West Virginia is doing when it comes to workforce development. So I was extremely proud of that. So anyhow, time and time again, we've heard people ask about our state's workforce effort and what we've done over the years. And today's summit showcases the significant changes we've brought about in the Mountain State. And today's conversation on workforce development is just the beginning, but there's still work, as Keith said, to be done. If you're a business or an industry operating in West Virginia, there's an unmet need, reach out to us. Let us know your needs and concerns, and we will work with you on training programs and opportunities for any of your workers. Our state's continued success is built on our strong business climate and skilled workforce. And I'm confident that together, we will ensure a bright future for West Virginia for generations to come. Thank you all for participating today. Appreciate it.